सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ A very good evening to you all and hearty welcome. Dear and revered monastic brothers and sisters, dear devotees and friends, this is really a wonderful topic for every one of us. As the topic says that we are trying to find out ways to form or reform habits. I am not going to discuss the science of habit here, but I would try to look at how habits are formed and how they can be reformed or changed. Someone said, one thinker said, that we do not live on this world for so many days. We actually live one day and repeat the same day so many times. Actually speaking, that is true. From morning till evening, what we do is nothing but a program. We are programmed that way. We have programmed ourselves that way. So every day is the same day. And, well, yes, at the end of the week, maybe from Friday evening, we try to do something different. We go out, pitch our tents everywhere, and or some kind of change or difference. But then again, that is every week the same. So, it is like you have the yearly calendar. Every year the same type of events, holidays and things come. In Sanskrit literature, these are called Nitya Naimittika Karma. Nitya karma, works that we do every day, and naimittika karma we do occasionally. But they come back again and again. So it speaks of a kind of habit, a kind of programming. And actually speaking, our habits reveal how much value we give to ourselves. Our habits will reveal how much self-respect we have. How much value we give to ourselves. And we cannot expect anything more than that from others. If I can't value myself, I can't respect myself, then how do I expect others to respect me? Actually speaking, our habits will evaluate our stature, our worth. This is a very, very hard truth. Once I heard from one of the assistants of Swami Baneshananda ji. He was that time 93, 94 year old, and doctors asked him to take rest after lunch, maybe 1 hour, So he used to take rest, means sleep for about half an hour, 40 minutes. One day he got up early, 15 minutes before 2 o'clock. And he asked his assistant to help him to come out of the bed, because at the age of 92, he underwent the bypass surgery. So the whole chest bone had to be cut open, and when at that age these things are done, then one needs to take lot of precautions. And also, so that, because we don't know whether the bones actually join together properly. So he asked the assistant to help him to get out. The assistant said, "Maharaj, still 15 minutes to go. You need to take rest, doctors have said." Maharaj said, "No, you help me, I will get up." He said, "No, you have to take rest." He said, "If you don't help me, I will get up myself." Then the assistant said, "Maharaj, enjoy some kind of more comfort. So take more rest." In Bengali this word is aram, in Sanskrit also arama. So arama means take some more rest or remain more comfortable. Then he said, "Aram haram hai." In Hindi there is a saying, this taking rest is nothing but spoiling you. At that age, he is saying these things. Look at the self-worth. One should learn these things. And that is how we are able to value ourselves. And then we can expect others to respect us that way. Actually speaking, we do value ourselves. We want to value ourselves. But we have confusion about who we really are. That is the confusion. I will try to discuss these things if the time permits. They say we have three layers of our being: sthula sarira, sukshma sarira, karana sarira. We have the physical body, then the mental sheath or subtle body, and the last one is the karana sarira, causal body. And when we identify ourselves to the physical body, our value is judged according to that. We value all the physical things. We value our physical comfort, physical enjoyment, physical happiness, if we identify ourselves with our physical body. And when we identify ourselves with our mind, then we value literary discussions, means a little bit higher, at the higher level. We try to discuss things, not persons. We try to discuss ideas, not persons. That is a little bit higher level than the physical level. And if we value our spiritual being, then we get one more level up or higher. Actually speaking, these three levels are not real. These three levels are not real. You are all students of Vedanta, you have heard it many times, that these three levels are not real. But in and through these levels, we try to achieve our goal. And if we attach ourselves to these levels, then we forget about the goal. So our habits are formed according to our identification with one of these levels or two levels. And we forget the goal. There was a teacher who used to teach his students about how to detach oneself from the physical body, from this world, how to practice detachment. But the students discovered that this teacher is himself much attached to a dog. So one day the students, they wanted to make some fun with the teacher, and they asked him, "What is the goal of life?" Then the teacher understood. He called the dog. Dog came. And then he said, "Fetch the moon." Then the dog looked up. The teacher asked the students, "Can you tell me to what thing is the dog looking?" Then the student said, "Looking at the moon." The teacher laughed and said, "No, he is looking at my finger." This is the indicator. And the thing which is indicated is forgotten. That happens. Particularly for the students of Vedanta, as Sri Krishna says, we get misled because after reading all about the indicator, all the scriptures, they are nothing but indicators. They indicate something else which is beyond the scriptures. That is why Sri Ramakrishna has said that his experiences, realization, has transcended the limit of the scriptures. Scriptures are the indicators, they are not the goal. So in Vedanta, most of our Vedanta students, we equate ourselves, our realization with the indicator, not with the real goal. That is why we suffer. Sri Krishna says, "Klesho dhikataraste sham avyakta sakta chetasam." Those who go through this path of knowledge, they have to really suffer a lot. Because we may misunderstand that when we understand the meanings of some scriptures, we think that we have realized. Sri Krishna says there is a yardstick to test if we are realized. We are too much attached to the body. And without my body, my things, myself, my ego, we don't give value to anything else. And at the same time we say that we are realized. We have realized Brahman. That is a kind of deceiving our own self. This happens because we mistake the ego for the self. And Sri Krishna says, "Na virato duscharita, na shanto, na samahita." If we do not stop our bad habits, we do not control our minds, we do not practice meditation, or do not achieve success in meditation, and say that we are pure, we are realized, that is deceiving ourselves. Vedanta teaches us how to differentiate between good and bad at the lowest level. And this good and bad are nothing but our accumulated habits. Good habits and bad habits. Someone has said the total value of one person is good or bad habits minus good or bad habits, equal to what remains. Good habits minus bad habits. or bad habits minus good habits, then what remains is our total worth. So we need to discriminate or differentiate, discern what is good, what is bad, what is permanent, what is impermanent. Swamiji has said that habit is our second nature. It's our first nature also, he says. It is all about our nature. So first nature is what we are born with, what we have brought with us, the earlier samskaras, which has helped us to begin with this life. And the second nature is what we learn in this life. Psychologically speaking, we have learned throughout the process of evolution one thing, how to be always afraid of things. That is a kind of defense mechanism. We learned how to be afraid of things, and therefore we build up our defense mechanism, and that is a negative way of forming habit, negative habits actually. And that is why when people are talking good ideas, good things, we are not much interested. But if we are talking ill of others, criticizing someone, rightly or wrongly, then many people are interested. You will form a group of nice people. So, because we love negative ideas, because that helps us to survive. That is the idea of survival mechanism. But one thing is, one idea is nice, that even if we are good, we can try to be better. That is the idea. That is how we need to change our habits. We may say, okay, I am fine. No, you can be finer. You can be better. There is always scope for betterment. So, the idea of forming and reforming habits is the idea of a change, you know. And that is the most difficult problem we have to face. You try to change your bed, wherever it is in the room, try to change the location. Change the position of your reading table. If you do it yourself, nice, fine. You don't mind that suffering. But if someone else does that, then big fight starts. Nothing, it is nothing, just a little bit change from this place to this place, the table has changed. But so much resistance from within. We have found our, created our comfort zone, and we love to remain there, feeling very safe. Nothing bad is going to happen because I am quite safe. So you may remember that great book written by Spencer Johnson, "Who Moved My Cheese?" Who moved my cheese? Changes in one's own life, at workplace, is really, really difficult. And wonderful story he has written about two mice that sniff and scurry, and two little people, they say hem and haw, indecisive. So, and when there was a change, the cheese which they used to get regularly, and they thought that was their cheese. Because you get the cheese always there, whenever you come, you have the supply. So you think that it is your right, and someone is supplying cheese for you. But suddenly one day everything got exhausted, or somebody removed everything. Then what happens? Now see how he narrated how easy it was for the mice to accept that change and move away and find another store of cheese. But for the human beings, it was difficult. Hem and haw. So when we become indecisive, they say hem and haw. So the person, little person called haw, somehow managed to accept this change and look for something elsewhere. But him will not accept it. He said, first, you have to answer this. Who moved my cheese? That was my cheese. See, that is how we say, this is my body. This is nobody's body. It belongs to this world. And modern science says that it is made of the ingredients available in this world. It is none of our property. And we say, it is my body. So these are all very serious things. So they developed a habit that the cheese is always available, guaranteed. So they were not willing to come out of their comfort zone, search for something better, to accept the change. And I would give you an example from that great, great movement. It is very famous here, even in Europe also it is very famous. It is called Alcoholics Anonymous. Bill Wilson. So he formed that one. He himself was a very bad alcoholic. And his friend was also alcoholic, and one day they met in a cellar in one New York house. And for several days or for a month, this friend was not appearing to drink. So once he appeared, then the friend, Bill, offered one glass of wine. He said, no, I stopped drinking. What? How could you do that? Then he explained how he took the help of God and God saved him and he became sober. So this, it was around 1890 something, 90s. So this Bill came out and he himself succeeded and he started with this Alcoholics Anonymous. And of the 12-point guidelines, 7 points speak of God in that. So if I have time, I will speak about that. But thing is that it speaks about a change and it is a kind of addiction. You see, the Upanishad, the word Upanishad has been explained or defined by Shankaracharya and other commentators. Upanishad means Upanishad. So Upa is one prefix, Ni another prefix. One prefix was not enough. They had to give another prefix, Ni, then Shad. Shad is the root word and the meaning of this word is to cut asunder, to cut. So Sat. So Sadguru, that word has come, but in English it is very dangerous. Sad Guru, it becomes sad. So Guru becomes sad. So Sadguru, the Sat, Sat. Sat means to cut asunder. And what is there to cut? So the attachment that we have grown towards things which are unreal or relatively real. And then Upanishad says, Ni word is very powerful because Ni means Nisheshena, completely, without leaving any trace of it. Why this Ni had to be used? Sat itself is enough. Cut it. Then Upanishad, the commentator says, it is used because we have grown an attachment. They say, how it is grown? They say that if I have liked something, I liked some face. So eyes are there to look at things. So if I see your face, it is no harm for me because eyes are there and it is not the fault of the eyes. Eyes are meant for that. But if I look at you second time, that shows that I have given an attention, a little bit attention. And if I look at the face third time, then it says that there is an intention. If I look at fourth time, it is attachment. And if I look at the same face again and again, it is called addiction. Ni prefix has been used because we have become addicted to these things, and that is what is called habit. That is what is called habit. We are addicted to something, and therefore habits have been formed that way. when we are addicted to our physical body, then physical habits have started. When we are addicted to our mind, the Swami Vivekananda has said that name and fame are the last hurdles of noble minds. They're hurdles. So addicted to name and fame, addicted to something, we will find out many things to get addicted to. So therefore, to come out of that addiction is not that easy. So we have heard in the scriptures, many times they have given a solution to all these problems. When in the Gita, Sri Krishna was asked by Arjuna, he says that it is as difficult as controlling the flow of the wind. When we try to control our mind, it is as difficult as controlling the flow of wind. So, how to control this, he is asking to Sri Krishna. Sri Krishna says, Abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha grihyate. By continuous practice and by practice of detachment. It seems to be too simplistic. And we have heard it again and again, it has no effect on us. This has no effect on us, but our bad habits have effect on us. Not only on us, on others around us. So we want to change it. In the Yoga Sutra also, the same thing has been said, Abhyasa Vairagya Abhyam Tan Nirodha. By practice, repetition, and Vairagya means detachment. And Vedanta also speaks of that, Nitya Nitya Vastu Viveka Iha Mutra Phala Bhoga Viraga, etc. So, these are the only two ways to form and reform habit that we need to practice. That is why when Sri Ramakrishna asked Totapuri, his guru, guru of non-dual Vedanta, why do you polish your brass pot, water pot, every day? Then Totapuri said, then otherwise it will gather, it will rust or gather dirt on it. So we have to do it every day or regularly and punctually. That is the idea. Otherwise everything will get rusted. Those who do physical exercises, they know it. When you stop doing exercise for some time, it is difficult to begin at that level. You have to again start from the scratch and go on practicing. It is lost because we are not practicing every day. In our order, there is a saying that spiritual life is not for Sunday, not for 5 days. It is a everyday life. There is no holiday in spiritual life. That's what they say. And that practice is necessary. Even to achieve any material success. I saw one YouTube video where they have tested with Cristiano Ronaldo. You know that great soccer player of Portugal. He was tested that when a ball is kicked, he is near the goal and the ball will be kicked towards him. As soon as the ball is kicked, the light is off. And they saw that he headed the ball into the goal. In darkness, complete darkness. And then they did it in complete darkness. Even the kicking of the ball was not visible. He put the ball into the goal with his shoulder. These are not something which is very mystical, very mechanical. Actually speaking, the whole process of our meditation, japa, these things are very mechanical. But the result is really mystical. Result is mystical. Practice is very mechanical. We have to do it. If you read the life of this great footballer or any great person for that matter, you will see they do it every day. They do this back-breaking practice every day. And that's That is needed if we want to achieve success in changing our habits. So they say, and it has been said in the Yoga Sutras also, that to effect any change in our habit for betterment or to remove bad habits, we need a thing called willpower. Willpower means a kind of self-discipline that has to be practiced. You see, there is a very big story about the Starbucks. This is a very ordinary thing, a commercial thing. But the Starbucks, the owner, this Howard Schultz, he led a very disastrous life in the beginning. Then afterwards he bought Starbucks. And he introduced and devised and introduced a kind of concept of training the employees. Afterwards, once he said that we are not in coffee business, we are in human business. Their training is such that when an employee is taken, he will be trained in such a manner, keeping the consumers in view, that the consumers, when they come to drink a cup of coffee, they want some kind of relief. That time, they are not, many of the times, they won't be in good mood. They may shout at the employee. So if the employee shouts back, then the employee loses the job. So here, before allowing these things, eventualities to happen, then Schultz devised and introduced a program of training the employees. The new employee will be sitting there, and a few of the old trainers will be sitting there and shouting at him, telling bad words. All these things will happen several days, one after another, maybe 30 days. And this person will be completely puzzled what to do, because these words he or she has never heard in life. And it was so annoying, but over the period of time, slowly they will get used to this. And they know that they are doing it for their own good. By bettering their life, they can help others to better their life. So Schultz has said, we are not in coffee business, we are in human business. And our employees take care of others' comfort to better their life. And by the way, we sell coffee too. So this is the idea of training. And this way they teach not a business skill, but a life skill. We all need to resist our anger, control our anger, our greed, our jealousy. We all need that. So these type of life skills are not taught in our schools, in our families, in our communities. They have failed to train us that way. Willpower is actually a learnable skill. One can learn it by repetition, by habit. It will become stronger and stronger if we go on doing the same thing again and again. Like when we train up our muscles by exercise, they become stronger. But how to think that there is something called willpower which will help us in our forming and reforming habits? They say if we have a goal in life, then things will automatically change and we will be willing to change them. If we have a goal, they say we live lives on this earth. If we have a goal, then our time is measured in life scale. And if we do not have a goal in life, then our life is measured in time scale. What is special about it? We lived so many years, 100 years. Rather, we have increased our life on the wrong end. Most of the time visiting doctors and keeping appointment with the doctors. But the skills that we are taught in our schools or in our communities or in our homes, they are something not helping us. You have heard that great experimentation by Harvard professors with the marshmallow experimentation with the children. So they have found that these curriculum or the training in the schools, they don't help us. They target these skills what we learn from the schools or communities, they are targeted towards a youthful and enjoyable life. That means the kind of program which is lifeless. We have been programmed like robots. Yeah, we are robots. That's what the evolutionary biology says. We are gene machines, but in modern day we can say we are programmed gene machines. What is the difference between robo and gene machine? We have not learnt life skill. We could not connect these programs to life skills. That is why we see that a great management professor managing many, many companies, the problems in the companies, giving big lectures to 500 employees in the companies, but they are failing at home, cannot manage small family. Why? Because there is no life in all these skills. They are just behaving like programmed gene machines. So what is necessary to build up habit or to change habit? In a hospital, in the orthopedic department, they have run a study among the very heavily handicapped people. They have seen that even some people who have got some problems, to help them to move their hands, it is really very difficult, painful. Particularly if you have fallen somewhere on the snow and injured your shoulder here, the doctor will ask you to move this hand like that, and it will be almost like cutting your muscles inside with a saw. But you have to do that. So how can we do that? So they say three things are necessary. One is a goal. That is, you see, these are all spiritual words, but they are used by these people in experimentation. We need a goal and an inspiration to achieve that goal, to reach that goal. And third thing is a preparedness to combat the peak point of pain. See, those who are trying to quit drug addiction, suddenly they will feel a peak point when it is difficult for them to remain without drug. They may kill people, they may kill themselves, but they want that drug, that the peak point. So preparation is necessary, preparedness to face that, combat that peak point of pain. So they have tested with many patients. One patient is very remarkable. One gentleman had broken hips, etc., etc. He was not able to walk. He was taking therapy after operation. It was difficult for him to walk with crutches, even 2-3 steps. Then these people spoke with his wife. His wife used to go back home after her work. They talked with her and said she would go via that way, and there the bus stops at one place. And she told the husband, that I can come down for a while there. If you can come there, we can meet daily. So he was so happy to see his wife every day. So he was happy with the proposal. Then he said, okay, I'll try. Then he knew the doctors have given him some tablets which he could use when there will be very big pain or excruciating pain. So that was the preparedness. He knew it was there with him. And second thing, there was a goal to achieve. And he liked that goal. And third thing, that the inspiration, that goal brought inspiration in him. So the person who was not able to walk 3 steps, he walked a few hundred steps and went to the bus stop. And many times he did not need those tablets. Many times he did not need those tablets. Because there was a zeal, that inspiration, and there was a goal fixed. So they say that if we look at the genesis of the habits, then we see that for each habit there is, suppose there is a die-hard habit, then we'll see that it is based on a kind of strong craving. Old habits die hard, they say. So if we have an old habit, then we'll see that it is based on an old craving. So strong habits are based on strong cravings. And that is what is called desire. So Yoga Sutra says, we are not able to enhance our willpower because of one fact, that there is a thing called pleasure pursuit which eats up our willpower. Pleasure pursuit. We are all after happiness. We want to attain happiness. And this happiness has got 3 names at 3 levels. When we derive happiness using our physical body, that is called pleasure. When we derive our happiness using our mind, that is called joy. And when we derive our happiness using our spiritual practices, that is called bliss. Physical pleasure is inferior to mental joy, and mental joy is inferior to spiritual bliss. Similarly, spiritual bliss is superior to mental joy, and mental joy is superior to physical pleasure. We will not use the physical body in such a way that it takes away our mental joy. Nobody will want that. So, this pleasure pursuit has to be stopped. Therefore, we need to practice something else which takes our attention away from these things. This is called desire in our Vedantic language, that kama. Kama means desire. Desire has got objects at the physical level, at the mental level, at the spiritual level. So we can get into the changed habits by three ways. That's what I want to discuss now to end this talk. The first thing is that by force we can change the habits or start with the new habit. That is what is called rehabilitation. In modern day language, that is called rehabilitation. We are taken to rehabilitation homes, and that is nothing but practicing same thing again and again, repeating the same thing again and again. That is what is called rehabilitation. There is nothing more than that. But we have seen, after this rehabilitation therapy, in many cases, the successes were not very high. That is why Alcoholic Anonymous has become so famous, because it is not speaking about traditional this rehabilitation therapy. They have a different kind of rehabilitation. So by force applied by these things, that can be changed. Some successes are there, but that does not stay for a long time. And second thing, with the help of God or Guru. That's what the Alcoholics Anonymous tries to propagate. Of 12 points, those alcoholics have to practice. Of those 12 points, 7 are speaking directly of God. That is why when the professor from the Harvard University came to study why they are having so much success without our stamp, then they found that they are speaking of God at 7 places. So they termed them as cult and went away. And then afterward they could not deny the success. They came back and studied it. And they studied and they were astonished to see how the successes happened. So we have to bring in God. One of our Swamijis used to say, his disciples, we are generally worldly people. Even when we come to a guru to take spiritual initiation, our mind is very much bound to the world. We are very much worldly. So this disciple, he said, it is very difficult for me to think of God. Like Girish Ghosh said, you know, in the life of Sri Ramakrishna, there was a character Girish Ghosh. And who was so notorious, he once remarked, if I had ever known that there will appear a savior like Sri Ramakrishna, I would have committed much more sins. I would have committed much more sins. So, these alcoholics and these worldly people, it is not easy for them to come out of those habits. So he told his guru, it is difficult for me to think of God, etc. This Swamiji told him, first 10 minutes you think of your work. Any urgent work, any difficult work, any important work you have to do, concentrate on that. Analyze that work. What way you can achieve success. Think of the defects of that work or think of the threats that may appear. Use your time, at least 10 minutes you think on that. And after that try to concentrate on God. And that was a huge success. Because this concentration on material things brought concentration. Brought about concentration, and the mind is the same. You can use the same mind for spiritual practices. It is concentrated. That's what the Yoga Sutra has said. Vishayavati va pravritti rutpanna manasasthiti nibandhani. He says, if you are thinking of material objects, there your result, successful result will be quick. And then your mind will be much inclined to concentrate. Vishayavati, Vishaya means this, oh, material things. Concentrate on any material thing. That will actually bring about the power of concentration in your mind. And that mind, wherever you use, it will be successful. So it is like that, an art. So if you are not able to think of God immediately, but start this way, slowly, slowly, God will appear in your life. And then Guru also is important. Guru helps us to come out of our defects and difficulties. There is a wonderful story about a judo teacher. There was a judo teacher who used to teach judo to the students. And there was a student who aspired to become the champion. So he was really working hard and preparing himself. He was excelling in his practices. Then he met with an accident and he lost his left hand. So now how he became very depressed. He went to his teacher and said, what can I do? The teacher said, I don't know how to help you. But there is an old judo teacher. who does not teach much nowadays. You can go to him, he may help you, because with one hand how will you do? Then this student went to him, then the judo teacher taught him, said, okay, I'll try. He taught him. But over and over again, the same move he is teaching. The same move. Then there came the day when there was a competition, and the student said, I am not going to register my name. The teacher said, no, you go and register. I guarantee you will succeed. He laughed, said, I have learned only one move. How can I succeed? You go. Then first round he won, second round he won, third round, semi-final. He was scared. I don't know how I am winning, but now it is a very big problem, semi-finals. The teacher said, stupid, what did I tell you? You go. He went and he won the final. He said, now my opponent, I know he will just kill me. I can't face him. The teacher said, what I say, you follow that. Go and fight. So he won. He could not believe that he won. He came back to the teacher and said, how is it that I won? I know only one move. The teacher said, I taught you the most difficult move, which is very difficult, which is not possible to defend. And the second thing is that your opponent has only chance to defeat you by catching hold of your left hand. So see, defects became a boon. So the teachers, they know how to guide us, how to help us. The third thing is what is called satsang. Alcoholic Anonymous also has told the same thing, the group discussions, satsang. And here satsang for the alcoholics is something different than our satsang. They are not talking about sat, they are talking about, yes, I tried 3-4 days, you know, to remain without alcohol. But the problem is, I had to drink one glass. But in 3 days, I drank only one glass. So they are sharing their experiences. So everyone is talking about that, but the main point was that they are all trying to succeed. That helped them. That gave them inspiration, that all these people are trying in our spiritual life. When we go to a satsang, are we all realized persons? That we are emanating light all around us, and gods and angels are moving around us, and we appear there. No, we are all ordinary people, worldly people. We are going to discuss satsang, discuss about God, discuss nice ideas, morality based on spirituality. All these things we are discussing. So this is what is called satsang. And there we are getting one inspiration that all of us are trying. All of us are trying. That helps. So the idea of satsang is highlighted there and in also in the scriptures. And when Sri Krishna looked at this problem, he said that, yes, it is very easy to get rid of any kind of habit. But that is the outer part of our real habit. Our main habit is the deep down inside us. And that is the thought of that thought. Sri Krishna says, rasavarjam rasopyasya param drishtva nivartate. We may be able to renounce or give up gross things which are disturbing us, but the thought of those things will remain in the mind. We will continue to enjoy their company. That can be removed by God's grace and by the help of the group, satsang. Satsang helps us to repeat this resolve that I am trying. And God's grace, as Holy Mother has said, that you can do this much of japa, this much of meditation, that will not help. It is the grace of God which helps. And how that helps, that cannot be explained to people. Those who have reached the end of their ability or tether. And that is the time when we are able to open up fully towards God. That is what is called surrender. And when we open up fully towards God and the grace pours in, and how much it is, until and unless you experience that, you won't understand. So, to change our habits, we need these few things. We need a goal. And if that goal is God, then we are saved from the beginning. And second thing is that we need an inspiration. And third thing is that we need a preparedness to fight the peak point of our disturbances. And if we value ourselves, if we value ourselves, we have an idea of our self-worth, then we will succeed 100% guaranteed. Thank you very much.